as we continue our study in the book of Acts. We're very excited to dive into Acts chapter 2 this morning. Trust that you're doing well, and trust that you've had a good day so far. The Lord certainly has blessed us with some great weather, and we're very, very appreciative of that, and still longing for the day where we can be together. But until then, we're going to press on in Bible study, and I think it's a great opportunity for us as a church family to read and study God's Word together. So we're going to dive into Acts chapter 2 this morning.
Yeah, and boy, I tell you, Acts chapter 2 is an incredible, incredible chapter. The birthday of the church, and the church is precious. It's God's gift. It's God's idea. And I'm telling you, it's been a powerful instrument, a powerful tool through the years. Amen. As God knits his people together, when saved people, the redeemed of the Lord come together and they worship and celebrate Jesus, but they also find equipping and power, as we've talked about. We plug into the right source together and we go out and multiply. That's the whole job of the church. So Acts chapter 2 is a power-packed chapter. I doubt very seriously we'll go very far into this today, because Acts chapter 2, as you may well know, is also one of the most controversial chapters, and can be controversial. It was never intended to be controversial, but I believe, like everything, the enemy gets his hands in things, disturbs things, confuses things, and makes things not what they should be. And so, Mark, is there any need for the church to be scared of Acts chapter 2 and the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the tongues of fire? Right. First and foremost, it's not fearful, is it?
No, I think if we are students of the Word, we dig into God's Word like we should. I think the reason that so many people are fearful of Acts 2 is, to be quite honest with you, I'll be the first to admit there was for a long while in my life, and even in my ministry, this was a passage that I really didn't want to spend too much time in, just simply because yeah. I didn't know enough about it. I hadn't read, I hadn't studied as I should have, but I know over the years where I have committed myself to studying God's Word, and specifically this passage in particular, you're exactly right. It's not a passage that we need to be fearful of or afraid of, but to be quite honest with you, it needs to be a passage that we run to and we hold on to, yeah. Especially in times like this. And I do find it very fitting that we're talking this morning about the preciousness of the church, yeah. In a time where we're not able to actually come together and be the church. But we need to know and understand that the church is not relegated to a building, but we're called to be the body of Christ. And so I think it's neat how God's laid this out for us this morning.
And maybe it'd be good if we could clear up, what is Pentecost? The word Pentecost, when we look at that, maybe it means 50th.
Right.
So what exactly is Pentecost, the word meaning 50th? What are we looking into there, that a lot of people in the church now, they hear at Pentecost, and they think it's some big movement that maybe we can duplicate or something?
Right. I think what you said earlier is what we need to understand about Pentecost. Pentecost literally is the birth of the New Testament church. It's where there is some very unusual things that we'll see and we'll read about a little bit this morning. But God used that in such a miraculous way to birth the New Testament church, in a sense. And from this moment forward, they've seen firsthand not only Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, but also now they have seen that God desires for his message of salvation to be communicated to the nations.
Yeah, and Pentecost was not a new
right
thing. They celebrated this often.
Every
time.
Yeah.
So 50 days in, mm-hmm. And when we look at this, we realize that It is something that happened. It's held 50 days after Passover.
Right.
They always had Pentecost. So we know that this was something that people had been flocking into the area. You'd had major celebrations, major feasts going on, and many people had flocked to Jerusalem. And Jesus in those days prior to this had been crucified, resurrected, and revealed himself to, as we can read, I think in 1 Corinthians, over 500 people.
Correct.
Had visually seen Jesus after the resurrection. And he told them to wait for the promise. So as you remember, they're in the upper room. They're praying. They're waiting. We know there's 120 of them that had assembled there. And they're waiting on this. So we see 10 days basically after our Lord ascends and goes back to be seated at the right hand of the Father. 10 days passes, and then, bam, the birthday of the church. So let's take a look at that. Acts chapter 2, verse 1, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. Now, like you said, that we would see some strange happenings going on. Look at verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So as we get to that point in our text today, they're all assembled in an upper room. First, there's a mighty rushing wind that fills that room. Then we see that there appeared to them cloven tongues like as of fire, but it sat on each of them. And then we notice that they all began to speak in verse 4. Let's look at it again, because these are three main things that happened. They were filled with the Holy Ghost when this happened. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. You know, here's what we need to say today. There's no way we could, as Baptists, teach this and there not be other denominations say they're dead wrong on that. They disagree with us. We disagree with them. A lot of the disagreement is wrapped around the tongues. It's wrapped around what does the tongues mean? We've all either talked about it, said things about it. There's a lot of, you know, misnomers about it, the talking in tongues. And as they sit together, if we don't get chapter 2 right biblically, we don't understand the book of Acts. This is the most important chapter in the book of Acts. What happens here is God sent his promise. What's the key to chapter 2? Is the key speaking in tongues? Or was the key the gift of the Holy Spirit? Hadn't that been what they was waiting on anyway?
Absolutely.
You know, they're waiting on the gift of the Holy Spirit. And God does it in a supernatural way where there is the rushing mighty wind. And then you've got the tongues, the cloven tongues as of fire that sits on each of them. And then they're filled with the Holy Spirit. And so when we look into that, God is, like you said, saying, this is what you've been looking for. And wouldn't it be just like God to make this in such a way they would never get over it? They would always remember the experience that they had. And now, for the first time in Scripture, the Holy Spirit has come, and here's the key word, folks, to abide with them. Not to just come, do a work, and move on. It's the abiding
it's
of the
Holy Spirit.
Setting
up of residence,
When did you get the Holy Spirit?
Well, when I gave my heart and life to Christ.
There's
no junior Holy Spirit. I used to remember a professor at Fruitland used to tell us that all the time. You don't get a portion of him now, and then installments later, but you get the entire full-fledged person and work of the Holy Spirit when you give your heart and life to Christ. I mean, it's that indwelling that comes in. The Bible's very clear about that, teaches that very very clearly, helps us to understand that when we trust Christ, that God comes in, he comes in, sets up residence, and then leads us and guides us according to the word and will of God.
Yeah, and I don't think there's much dispute on the fact that when we get saved, we get the Holy Spirit.
Sure.
But there are other denominations and beliefs that say we don't get all of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And like you said, we don't believe that way. We believe you get all of the Holy Spirit you're ever going to get when you get saved.
Yeah.
At the moment of salvation. I was 8 years old.
Right.
How old were you, Mark?
Eight years old. Yep.
So we were both 8 years old, and at 8 years old, we got all of the Holy Spirit that we was ever going to get.
Absolutely.
And get. And so that's what we believe. There was one baptism of the Spirit of God on our lives.
Yes.
The day we got saved. But since then, the Spirit of God has made himself so known to us, fills us up on occasions.
Yes.
And it doesn't mean we got more of him. I think it's just we tap into, recognize, and feel.
Yeah, we become more aware of his presence and the active work that he has in our life. I mean, it's just like when you're a child and you begin the process of learning to walk. You start walking, and the more you walk, the better you become at it, the better you understand all that goes with that, and then you learn to run and all those other things. You learn to ride bikes and things. But the basis is you have what you need in the beginning to accomplish that. And so when we give our heart and life to Christ, we receive in full the Holy Spirit. But as we grow in Christ, we become more aware and more knowledgeable of his work in and through our life.
Yes. And I think one thing we ought to write down in our study today about these first four verses, take the word abide. The Holy Spirit came to abide. This is a different thing that's ever happened. In the Old Testament and up to this point, the Holy Spirit had set on people for a specific work and a period of time, and then removed himself
right.
to come back and do other works. Now, the Holy Spirit has come in, set on each of them to abide with them. Look, write down John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17. Listen to those verses. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that is the Holy Spirit, that he may abide with you forever.
Yeah.
Forever. Even the Spirit of truth. Pentecost for the church was once for all. Here's one thing we need to get down, and here's what we believe according to the Bible. This Pentecost that happened, this specific one, was a once for all time.
Yeah, it was a once for all event.
It can't be redone, can
right.
it, Mark?
That's
I mean,
right.
I think since then what's happened is people, maybe with good intention, have tried to duplicate Pentecost.
Mm.
They've got together in rooms and they've sat down and they've prayed, God, send what you sent at Pentecost. Well, he did. If you've been saved, he gave you the Holy Spirit just like he gave them the Holy Spirit.
Absolutely.
But remember, this is the birth of the church. And they saw it in such a powerful way. And they had the same feeling of the Spirit. When you and I got saved, if you remember the day you got saved, then you remember the freedom that came with
yes.
that. There was new life on the inside of you. Burdens had been lifted. Old yeah. things were gone, and everything became new. The sweetness of the Comforter
yes.
had come to abide with us. But here's what we need to understand. The day, this specific day, cannot be duplicated no more than the crucifixion could be duplicated.
Right.
Nor the resurrection. Those were once for all acts. Jesus is not going to be crucified again.
Yeah.
We can't go back and redo the resurrection. When he got out of the grave, it's a once for all. And the moment this happened in the upper room was a once for all occasion, a Pentecostal movement that happened on Pentecost where the Spirit of God came.
Yeah.
He did not come upon the company of the upper room and then go away to be poured out in individual believers in different ways. He didn't do that.
Right.
This was the birth of the church, and he came to abide. So first and foremost today, let's get that word down. abiding. Now the Holy Spirit has come to abide. I love that, don't you guys, today, that as we study our Bible, he abides with us.
Absolutely.
He don't leave us and come back and revisit us, and we have to come into church and manufacture something. He abides with us. Now, the outpouring of the Spirit on Pentecost, was that, you know, when we look, it's not necessarily the result of anything the disciples did. They went and waited, just like God told them. They obeyed. Yeah. And the Spirit did not come in response, maybe essentially to their prayers. He didn't come because they were in one accord. He came because it was time for him to come, right?
Yeah, I think we have to understand that God is not mechanical. He is relational when it comes to that. We tend to think that if we, you know, if you've ever been in a service where there were certain things that took place that were so amazing and exciting, and you think, well, what we've got to do then is we've actually got to pattern our services all after that same service.
Right.
And we do that in an effort because we believe that somehow, some way, that if we can mechanically box God in, that God is obligated to operate in the same fashion. But God is not mechanical, he's relational.
Amen.
And so it's important for us to remember, and what you said earlier about Pentecost being a it was a one-time event to set the pattern of how the Holy Spirit indwells the person at salvation for all time. And so we need to understand that this is not a pattern that needs to be mechanically organized to where we can force God to operate a certain way, but it's an evidence of the relational aspect of God.
Yeah, and remember that the Holy Spirit is in every believer.
Yes.
Today, absolutely. Everywhere a believer goes, the Holy Spirit is there. So no matter if we're in this church building or not, the Holy Spirit is with us. We kind of preached along this line Sunday. His presence is with us in all of our trials and everything we go through. So we don't have to sit and wring our hands all week and say, I've got to get back to church where the Holy Spirit is, or I can feel God or feel his presence. Mark, after this, When they got the Holy Spirit, it baptized them. They came to live in the inside of them, be their comforter, and abide with them. We'll see this later in a study, but they'll go out and they'll start sharing the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
And as they share the gospel, every believer that gets saved, was they instantaneously given the Holy Spirit as well?
Yeah, at the moment of salvation, that's the pattern that's set forth in Holy Scripture, is that when a person prays and receives Christ as Savior and Lord, the great work of grace that God does in our lives is really marked by the giving of the person and work of the Holy Spirit, because the role and responsibility of the Holy Spirit is to guide us into all truth. And so when we're reading and studying our Scripture, and I can attest to this, I remember reading the Bible as, you know, a seven-year-old boy. And I literally a lot of times would scratch my head and go, well, what does that mean? But it's not that I instantaneously, when I became 8 years old and gave my heart to Christ, that I understood all of it.
Yeah.
But the Holy Spirit was there in my heart and in my life when I gave my heart and life to Christ, that when I opened the Bible then, after coming to know Christ, the Bible was open to me. It made more sense because the Spirit of God lived on the inside. As I read God's Word, the Spirit of God would affirm the truths that I was reading on the page.
Yeah.
And they would be made applicable to my life, even as an 8-year-old boy.
So the Holy Spirit's a guide, a
absolutely.
Teacher,
yeah.
A comforter. So would it be right to say that people who are saved change? You can't stay the same.
I sure hope so.
Isn't
our prayer.
Isn't it the job of the Holy Spirit to nudge us when we do wrong?
Yeah, my prayer is that none of us are the same individual we were when we first got saved. I pray that there's growth and development in my life that's visible, that's obvious, just as I pray that for every person who comes to know Christ, because as we study, the Spirit of God reveals to us the things that are in our life that don't add up to, that don't comply with God's Word, and does spiritual surgery, you know, with that scalpel of God's Word, and cuts away the things that need to be cut out of our life. And and puts in and imputes those things that need to be into our life.
Yeah.
So, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and you know, I've said this many times, and we're not going to go too fast with this because I want us to nail it down. The Holy Spirit is precious.
Yes.
And, you know, when we come together as churches and we go assemble together and we worship together and make decisions together, you know, we all come from different backgrounds, different upbringings. Michelle and I are complete opposites in our upbringing. I was very sheltered, and she traveled everywhere. I stayed in one place. I grew up in a home that was always in church. She did not. So our upbringings was different, but we both were saved. I was saved at 8. She was saved a little later in life, but we both were given the Holy Spirit. Now, we have different tastes. She eats things that I don't eat. She sees things differently sometimes than I see things differently. But, you know, I think as a group of believers, we all have that. Some of us like to decorate different ways. Some of us drive different vehicles and believe strongly in it.
Sure.
We spend our money different. We save our money different. But here's what makes us together. Here's what brings us together.
Amen.
And it's that beautiful gift of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So all of these different believers, we all come into the building. We all do things different in life. We eat different foods. And we like to vacation in different places. And we like different sports, or we don't like sports at all. None of that matters.
Right.
When we come together, we exalt one name, the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And as saved believers, the Holy Spirit applauds that, and He fills us. And you know that. If you've been in church, you've felt His presence. You feel the sweetness of what it's like for us to be together in the Holy Spirit.
Absolutely.
What a precious gift it was. And here's the thing. If you're saved, you cannot sin and enjoy it.
Amen.
Because the Holy Spirit lives in you.
That's right.
And He's going to knock, and He's going to make you aware, whoa, you should not have said that. That's a word you shouldn't have said. That is something you should not have typed. That is something you shouldn't have posted.
Absolutely.
That is something you shouldn't have drank, a place you shouldn't have been in. I promise you, one of the keys to knowing you're saved is it's the Holy Spirit's job to correct you when you're wrong, to say to you, that's got to be corrected. So if you feel wrong when you sin, praise God.
Yeah.
He you know then, hey, this is, now there's a lot of people know that that's a wrong thing to do, but they don't have any guilt.
Right.
They don't have any conviction when they do that. We're not talking about the difference in right and wrong. The Holy Spirit takes it even to a further degree that we've got to be very careful and sensitive how we speak to one another, and the Holy Spirit reproves, and He helps us to see that that we've got some things to straighten out.
Absolutely.
Okay, the word abide. And then to understand that everybody that gets saved is given the gift of the Holy Spirit. But did you notice something else that happened in that room? And I want you to notice the accompanying manifestations here. There was a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind.
Right.
Then there was, you know, you look in here, three things really happened in the text as we saw it today. And thirdly, in the third one, they began to speak in other languages.
Right.
So first you have a wind, then you have the fire, then you have the different languages.
Right.
Why in the world is it that we've put so much emphasis on the languages? Pastor Mark, what do you think the languages were?
Well, I think when you study it out, I think there's some Greek words that are used there in chapter 2 that kind of give us a very clear understanding that these languages were just that. They were languages of the people of that day that God supernaturally empowered those men on that particular day to speak in those languages, never having known them prior to that, but giving them supernatural ability to do so for one purpose and one purpose only.
It
was to propagate or further the gospel.
Amen.
That's the whole concept behind Acts 2. It was never for a show. It was never for a manifestation of personal growth or personal pride. It was always to take the gospel and extend the gospel to a lost and dying world. That's the whole purpose behind Acts 2, and how neat is it that on that particular day of Pentecost that you had people of a great number of places gathered in one geographical location, and we can sit back and say, well, that's just coincidence. No, that's the sovereignty of God on full display there. God had them there for that specific purpose, and for that reason, He empowered these men to speak in these known languages for the sole purpose of taking the gospel to the ends of the earth.
So you'd agree that the scripture does not say, for I have come to seek and to save, and so that they might speak in tongues. Or I've come to seek those who will speak
Correct.
In tongues.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's one purpose.
Yes, absolutely.
And guys, we need to nail this down to be biblical. When we look at the entirety of the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2 being the birthday of the church, the Holy Spirit would be the gift, the comforter. He would abide with us when we get saved. But it was not so that we could speak in an unknown tongue Amen. And that we could meet together, that would make us more spiritual or set us on a different plane. Listen, God sent His Son to save lost people, to save us, to redeem us.
Amen.
So His primary role, what He wanted accomplished here, was that all of the visitors who had come to Jerusalem could hear the gospel in their own language. Yeah. And then in turn, after being saved and given the gift of the Holy Spirit to abide in them, would walk back to their homes. And what would they do? Tell the gospel.
Amen.
Because they had heard it in their tongue. They could take it back to their people in the tongue that they spoke in. And there you have the multiplication of the church.
Yes.
He told the disciples this, greater things you will do than I have done. And the gift that He's given them here that day, just in one setting, they come out of that room and people got to hear the gospel. They got to hear about Jesus for the very first time in their own language. And I tell you what a glorious sight that must
Absolutely.
Have been, as groups of people would be huddled up and they would be hearing the message in their own language. That's the thing. As Pastor Mark just said, there's one purpose. There's one purpose to the church today, and it's the same purpose that was to the early church right here.
Absolutely.
Go tell the world the gospel. But we don't all speak the same language.
Right.
And we send missionaries to foreign soil, and they go to language schools, and they learn to speak that language. And let me tell you, I think it's a gift. I listened to John Grasty, one of our missionaries, and he was doing Psalm 23, and I don't know one thing that he said. I could follow along just English version, but he was speaking in the language that is in Slovenia,
right.
And I'm telling you, a masterful, I guess, because I don't know the language, but it's incredible to think, here's a boy, grew up right here, you hear how I speak, can you imagine? But John has a gift.
God gifted him.
There is a power that comes with that. People are going to get to hear the gospel in their own language. And let me tell you, I think it doesn't need to go any further than that. It doesn't need to be overcomplicated. Leave it to people to overcomplicate everything, right?
Yep.
And that we need to take such a precious thing and say, oh, well, maybe we need that gift. And maybe we need to sit around and speak in these unknown languages. We as Baptists, we love the brothers and sisters in Christ, and I believe a lot of them are in Christ.
Absolutely.
I believe we're going to spend eternity with them in heaven. But we do disagree on this point. I've been Baptist my whole life. I know I'm saved. You can't talk me out of that.
Right.
You believe you're saved
Absolutely.
Today, Mark? Well, I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
In all of your salvation days, have you ever spoken tongues?
No,
but not. But do you think you're still going to heaven?
I do. I do.
Now, guys,
that.
You won't believe this, but I went into a church one night. Shell and I had moved into this area to pastor a church, and we were new to the area, and I saw they were going to have a revival. It's a different denomination. I just wanted to go worship with the brothers and the sisters, you know. And I went in and sat down, and the evangelist got up. Midway through his message, he made it very clear. And he called out even Baptist people, and he said that, I want you to know, if you've never spoken tongues, and you don't have any desire to do that, and you haven't been given that, you're not going to heaven. Mm-hmm. But here's the unique thing that happened. There was not one alarm bell went off in me that, uh-oh, I'm going to hell.
Right.
I'm not. I wasn't scared about that. Let me tell you, I know I'm going to heaven because, one, I know I was saved. I was there when it happened. And number two, the Spirit of God lives on the inside of me.
Yeah, and there's great danger in that thinking in terms of, you know, to suggest that from a pulpit.
Yeah.
And again, we do love, I have some tremendous friends who are part of denominations that believe in and practice the concept of speaking in tongues. And I love them from the depths of my heart. And I truly believe that they're believers in Christ, and I'll be in heaven with them one day.
Sure.
However, the danger of this is to suggest that it's Jesus plus something else.
There it is.
If we believe that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection on the cross is sufficient for our sins, and I certainly believe that. I believe that it's Jesus and Jesus alone is the sole means of our salvation, the work that he did on the cross for my sins and the sins of the world. If I suggest that there needs to be something else in addition to that, then I have in turn minimized and even trivialized his death, burial, and resurrection. I have caused it to look less than God intended it to be. He intended it to be the pinnacle of everything in our faith, because everything hinges on the fact that Jesus got up out of the grave. Because Paul said that if Christ be not risen, then we are among all men most miserable.
Yeah.
And so I truly believe that there is great danger in suggesting that it's Jesus plus anything. It's Jesus and Jesus alone.
Amen.
For salvation.
Amen. And I just want to say to you today, I don't think every church or different denomination believes like that evangelist.
I agree.
I don't believe that. I think he was off in left field himself. And my friends who are of different denominations who believe in speaking in tongues, they're not like that. They're very loving for the most part. Now, you've got different kinds everywhere, just like Baptists.
Sure.
There's all different kinds. And I just want us to know today that we want to stay true to the Bible.
Absolutely.
Next time we come together Thursday, what I want us to do is we're going to continue on this thought. And here's the reason. We're not trying to cause controversy. We want to nail these things down. We're going to look at this fact. After Acts chapter 2, how many times do we see tongues? And why do we see tongues mentioned? We'll see it in the church at Corinth. We'll look a little at that. And then we're going to look at this thought. How many of the great church fathers did this?
Right.
Did they speak in tongues? How many men of God has been used greatly of God through history? Did they speak in tongues? Is it a requirement? Because I meet a lot of people who really have troubled themselves over that. Maybe something's wrong with me spiritually because I've never been given this second baptism, or I've never spoken in tongues. So does that make me less than? Am I not as important? And so I want us to just keep digging a little bit, because we covered today that he came to abide, and I really wanted us to see that. I also wanted us to see this, what Pastor Mark taught us today, is it was one purpose,
right,
to get the gospel out. And take away that saying, Mark, give it one more time. It's not robotic, but
yeah, God is not mechanical
in
how we interact with him. He's relational. We can't, you know, wrap God up in this mechanical box, because that's not who God is. God is relational. He's demonstrated that in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He sent him.
Yeah.
He expressed his love. It wasn't mechanical.
Yeah, not every worship service that I've been part in felt the same.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sometimes I came and went, and not much happened. But I'll tell you, Jesus was still the same.
Amen.
He's still on the throne. But sometimes in my devotional life, my prayer time, sometimes I've been riding along listening to a song, and the sweet Spirit of God met with me in a special way.
Amen.
He was always there. I had as much of him as I'm ever going to get.
Yes.
But sometimes it's just a sweet feeling. Many feelings one baptism. Mm-hmm. And we'll continue this thought on tongues in the early church, what was meant by it, and we'll watch what happens in the early church as God begins to pour out his Spirit upon many. We love you today. Thank you for this time we could spend in the Word. And you know what? We'll see you when we see you.
Well, thanks for being with us in worship today. It is our heart's desire that through the Word and through this worship service today, God has spoken to your heart and you desire to serve him and to worship him more than you ever have in your life. You know, if you've been watching today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, that is our greatest desire. If we can be a help to you, if we can assist you in any way, please contact us at the information you see on the screen. We also want to thank those of you who watch us regularly. We greatly appreciate your prayer and support. Keep praying for us as we pray for you, as we serve the Lord together.